We're good? Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, each and every one of you, for joining us here this morning. Certainly appreciate the hospitality from Northwest Community Co-op Center. Thank you for hosting us today. We do appreciate it. So we have Nancy Heinrichs, Executive Directors, and Ken Grove, and Project Manager Laura Horodecki. Great. So thanks again for the hospitality. We appreciate being here this morning on a beautiful, sunny Manitoba morning. Certainly, I also want to introduce from True North Youth Foundation, we have Dwayne Green and Susie Friesen. So thanks again for joining us here this morning. I appreciate you being with us. I have some colleagues from the legislature, Ministers Friesen, Stefanson, and Goertzen, and also joining us is our friend from Rossmere, Andrew. We appreciate you being with us this morning. And I also want to welcome this morning members who have been working on a cross-departmental team, who have been working hard behind the scenes on initiatives that will help Manitobans who are struggling with mental health and addictions issues. In a moment, we're going to get the ministers to talk about the details around these initiatives. And these are really meaningful initiatives, all of which are designed to help children and youth with services and educational tools that will help them make positive choices in their lives. These initiatives are a continuation of our government's work to modernize mental health and addictions programming across the province. We've got to receive information from experts who said that our previous methodology was antiquated and difficult for patients to access. As a recently re-elected government, today's announcement also serves as a kickoff to more than a dozen initiatives we intend to move forward with between now and the end of the year. And many of the initiatives we will be rolling out in the weeks ahead will focus on children and youth with complex multi-system needs, addictions, mental health and trauma support, and mental health promotion and universal supports. These will make a positive difference in the lives of Manitobans. We know we've accomplished a lot in a relatively short period of time, but we recognize there is much more work to do. That's why we are continuing to take action, including today's announcement. I would like to introduce my colleague, the Minister of Health, Seniors, and Active Living, Minister Friesen.
Good morning, everyone. Bonjour tout le monde. It's my pleasure to be here this morning with Ministers Cullen, Stefanson, and Minister Goertzen, and also, of course, with Andrew Micklefield, MLA for Rossmere. Thank you, Nancy, Ken, and Laura, for your hospitality and having us here this morning. A couple of us ministers just had the greatest conversation a few minutes ago with Angie, Jami, and Leah, and they're over there. Wave at us, girls. They were telling us all about the center and their training that they've recently undergone and what this youth center means in this community, in their lives, and in the lives of so many people. They even get to do homework and get tutoring if they need it after school some days of the week. So it's just wonderful to see all the myriad of ways in which a place like this is used on a daily basis, and we all know its significance in the community. It's my pleasure to be here to make a very meaningful announcement. We know, and we've said often, that in the province of Manitoba, mental health and addictions were ignored for many, many years. The Virgo report reported back that the mental health and addictions services in the province of Manitoba were largely siloed, that there were great people working in those areas, but the connections between those areas were lacking, and there was need to better coordinate these services to bring down wait times and to create access, not just at an acute level, but at a community level to be able to get to people and get them the services they need before things became too significant as challenges. Many Manitobans are youth, and we know that about one in four Manitobans aged 10 or older have a diagnosed mood or anxiety disorder. That means 75% of people, I should say 25% of people in our communities have some degree of familiarity firsthand with mental health issues. And we know that the majority of those mental health issues, we have an onset before the age of 24. That means that these are our sons and daughters, our nieces, our nephews, our brothers and sisters, and our neighbors that we're talking about. Our government in just 3 years has done a lot of work to improve mental health access and mental health services to Manitobans, but we know that there is always much more work to do. And I'm here to tell you as Minister of Health, and my colleagues will as well, that we are up to the challenge. We take this work very, very seriously, and we are making investments that we know will create that access and service for people that Manitobans need. It begins here. It begins today at Norwest Community Co-op Health Center, which is the home to the Norwest Youth Hub that offers a range of services for people between 14 and 24 years old. And I am proud to announce this morning that the Youth Hub will be significantly expanding the services that it offers thanks to a new $823,000 investment by our government. This investment will be spread out over the next 3 years. It will help the hub to help an additional 150 youth per year. And it will allow youth to access mental health and addiction services more easily by providing funding for the following: an additional 800 counseling appointments, an additional 125 psychologist appointments, 200 more primary care visits, and 350 more mental health support group sessions. So thank you. So this investment responds to recommendations made in the Virgo report. It will improve mental health services for youth in Manitoba, right here in this community. And most importantly, it is an investment in the mental well-being of the youth of this province and this city. Today's announcement reflects this all-of-government approach that we're taking to address mental health and addictions, and it reflects the vital role that community organizations like Norwest play in addressing this problem. When we work together towards common goals like we are doing here, there's nothing that we can't achieve together. Thank you, everyone. Merci beaucoup.
Thank you very much, Cameron. We appreciate those positive words, certainly pointing out the great work that's being done here. And certainly from my perspective as the Minister of Justice, the more services we can provide youth, the less chance they're going to become involved in the justice system. So it's really important work that you're doing. Certainly this morning there's also a component regarding education, and I also want to bring to the podium a good friend, Minister Goertzen.
Good morning. Thank you, Minister Cullen. It is a pleasure to be here with my colleagues and my friends. I want to tell you, as the Minister of Education, those fine young students have been given permission to be away from school today only until noon, and then they have to get back to school, good Sizzler Spartans that they are. It is an honor to be here today to make an announcement on behalf of our government when it comes to investments into mental health and the lives of young people. When I first heard of the story of Rick Rippon and his untimely death in 2011, I think I had the question that many people did, whether they were sports fans or not. Why? Why would somebody who is at the peak of their career, who is making more money than certainly politicians make, who is in the NHL and living the dream of many Canadians, why would they take their life? And that question, I suppose, could have stayed there, and True North could have done what many franchises do when they are faced with this kind of a tragedy. Could have held a night of honor, and they could have brought the family in and probably donated some money to a worthwhile and relevant cause, and True North did those things. But then they decided to go one step further, and Craig Heisinger their general manager, who had a special relationship with Rick Rippon, decided that there needed to be more of a legacy, that there needed to be more than just a night of honor, and there needed to be more than just a night of recognizing a great hockey player's life. And so they started up Project 11 and started to raise money through the foundation. I've been buying these pins, these RR pins. Sometimes people ask me, does this stand for Rolls-Royce? And it doesn't stand for Rolls-Royce. It stands for Rick Rippon. I've been giving them away over the years to young people who have asked me questions about it, and it gives me the opportunity to talk about Project 11. And so today, we are pleased to provide $621,000 over the next 3 years, which will be used to help an additional 5,000 students in our education system get the mental health training and understanding and resilience that Project 11 helps to provide through their cross-curriculum work that they do. And please thank the good folks at Project 11 for the work that they do. I had the opportunity a couple of days ago, and thinking about today, to go onto their website, Project 11 website. And if you haven't done that, please do over the next few days. And there's this great video that's produced by, I think it's produced by TSN, and it's a little bit about Rick's life and how Project 11 came to be. And it talks a little bit about to his father. And his father says that had there been something like Project 11 in the school system when Rick was going through to help young people understand some of the warning signs of mental health challenges, to talk about resiliency, coping strategies, that it might have made a difference in the life of Rick. And so we are pleased as a government to be able to provide support to a great community organization that is doing great work, and hopefully, and we believe, that there will be young people whose lives will be changed, whose lives will be saved as a result of this support. And it'll be a true legacy to Rick Rippon and to Project 11. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Kelvin. Obviously, teaching children and youth with coping skills to maintain and improve their mental well-being is very key to helping them make positive choices as they grow up. So in the final initiative, I'm going to call on the Minister of Families, Minister Stefanson, to come forward.
Good morning, everyone. I'm just so delighted to be here this morning with all of you who work here in this incredible facility, but those of you who volunteer in this facility and everything that you offer the youth who most need it. I really enjoyed our tour here this morning with all of you, and just it's very, very humbling to be a part of this today. To be a part of what you do on a daily basis to help these youth. So I just want to say on behalf of all of us here, thank you for everything that you do. This is an incredible initiative that you do here, and we very much appreciate it. It's great to be a part of this today. So good morning, everyone. I'm delighted to be here with my colleagues and just, you know, and help announce initiatives that will make a significant difference, I think, in the youth mental health and addictions in our communities. More specifically, I'm here to announce the expansion of Thrival Kits to more young people across Manitoba. One of our greatest opportunities to deal with the challenges of mental health and wellness is to give youth the tools and information they need at a young age. This helps young people build resilience, growing up with a better understanding of their own mental health and how they can cope with challenges, and perhaps most importantly, know that they're not alone in this whole initiative. With an investment of $1.5 million over the next 3 years, we will be putting Thrival Kits in the hands of more students in Manitoba, up to 15,600 young people from grades 4 to 6 in our province. So Thrival Kits are tools used in classrooms to help connect youth with evidence-based mental health practices through activities, things like mindfulness, personal reflection, how to recognize and reduce stress, and how to develop healthy coping skills. We'll be partnering with the Canadian Mental Health Association to expand the reach of these Thrival Kits, Building on a pilot project they led in partnership with the Manitoba Advocate for Children and Youth and in collaboration with teachers across this great province of ours. Since they were first introduced in a pilot project in 2017, schools, parents, and many others have told us these Thrival kits are working for these young people. In this school year, Thrival kits will be introduced to 120 classrooms. Further expansion will occur over the next two school years. And beginning next year, Thrival bundles will also be distributed with Indigenous content to ensure it's culturally relevant for more students in our province. This expansion is helping us meet the demand, building on a program that we know can make a big difference in all of these children's lives. You know, as a parent, I take great comfort in knowing that we are doing more to support young people with a continuing of supports and services, beginning with the simple but effective mental health activities and resources available through these Thrival kits. The expansion of these Thrival kits is great news, I think, for Manitoba, for Manitobans, their families, and their schools and their communities. And it's an example of, I think, how we can really work together across not only government departments, but across communities to ensure that we have the tools that we need to give the hope for these young people. So again, thank you for allowing me to be here today. This is a wonderful day for mental health and addictions for our young people in our province. Thank you.